send you back an expired message.
Cool.
So then you can print that the router who sent you that expired message was the first step. Then you'll send a counter with one. This time you'll make a debugger one step further, print the message, and then print that you made a debugger. We'll do that for Telia as well. And then when we get to GitHub, we'll get a normal response back. So we'll print that we made it there, how long it took, and then we'll stop incrementing that counter. And that's actually how Tracer works. But since Tracer itself is a hack, I can abuse it with my own hacks. So rather than sending TTL expired messages just if I get a packet with a TTL of 0, what happens if I also send it for any packet that has a TTL less than a certain amount? Say the amount we want to pretend is like farther away by. So concretely, if I got a request like this, time to live is 0 and it gets to me, but the packet was destined for me in the first place, so I should really be sending a normal response. But instead, I'll send a TTL expired response. Then when I get a response with a TTL of 1, this time, or a request with a TTL of 1, this time I'll actually send it. To Tracer, it looks like this happened. There was one extra hop along the way, and so it's going to print out one extra line. Looks a little bit like this if you implement it in like pseudocode Python. So we see two duplicate lines in there. And we can obviously add multiple steps, and we can spoof who we send that TTL expired message from to control the IP addresses that we see in this output. And that's all very well and good, but we said we're going to tell stories. And stories aren't told with numbers, they're told with words. Which means we need human-readable names on these, not just IP addresses. The way Tracer is defining the host names on each of those steps is using reverse DNS, which is, like everything else in this talk, a hack on top of DNS. So DNS is very simple, it just lets you map a host name to an IP address. That's how we resolve names on the internet. But let's say that you wanted to know, given I've got this IP address, which host name does it go back to? That's not immediately obvious, because it's the one-way look. What we could do, though, is DNS has this cool property that for a host name, you can strip off any prefix and you'll get to like a broader source of truth. So if I want to know who owns color.io, I can strip off the color and just ask who owns.io. They should know who owns color.io. So if we want to do this for IP addresses, we could, hypothetically, reverse the IP address, stick a special thing on the end, and then do exactly the same mapping. Which is what reverse DNS does. It's a total hack on top of DNS. Because it's a total hack, that means there's no actual protocol requirement that those two things match. I can set the reverse DNS record to something totally arbitrary. And not only can it be totally arbitrary, it doesn't have to match the forward pointing record, it can also just not be a valid host name at all.